I can't believe I'm back for this again. And I'm likely gonna have the biggest target on my back. I did the previous last one standing, and I came in first or second place in almost every challenge.
I am the first. That is amazing.
I ended up within seconds of the title. Waz had a better strategy, I'll admit.
Yes!
I didn't come out here to f around. I am getting that title this time.
I'm Dan Link. I am a local Honolulu resident. Been here for about 10 years. And I have been on Naked and Afraid. I've been on Discovery Channel's Naked and Afraid about 5 times now and survived over 140 days. A little bit more. That includes the current Naked and Afraid Last One Standing, a competition spinoff that's airing now. I have been to Chiapas, Mexico, in a cold pine forest for my very first challenge back in 2018, followed by 21 days in the Chihuahuan Desert on the Texas-Mexico border. Extremely arid, extremely remote, pretty cool location. And then I jumped from that to 60 days straight in the Peruvian Amazon. That was by far the most brutal challenge I've ever done, physically anyway. And then I did Naked and Afraid Last One Standing's first season, its very first competition spinoff, last year in South Africa, in Ruby Gorge. And what's currently airing now on the Discovery Channel is the second season of Last One Standing. Again, 45 days, also in South Africa, but in the northern region of Limpopo in the Munzwa Valley. I actually got involved with this back in 2018. I had seen a few episodes of Naked and Afraid and thought it was an interesting show, thought it was a crazy concept and looked like a hell of an adventure. But then I saw something on Facebook randomly that said, if you or anyone you know wants information on being on Naked and Afraid, send us an email. I was on a break at work, sitting at my computer. I thought nothing of it. I clicked on it, my email popped up, and I sent a couple sentences and a phone number. And didn't expect a reply. I got a call an hour later. And I walked out of work, sat outside on the phone for about an hour and a half, having this crazy impromptu interview. I got off the phone, I was like, that's kind of weird. Surprising. I got another call the next day for a follow-up interview. Had another interview a few days later, and at that point I was like, okay, I really need to think about this for a second. but I thought about it. It seemed crazy, potentially irresponsible. I've never done anything like that before. I was going to be projecting myself to the whole world, all of my mistakes, everything. But I pushed through that, did some training, and a month later I was in Mexico for my very first challenge. After like the third interview, when I really started thinking about this, I told my husband about it, and he was like, this is irresponsible, you haven't thought this through, like, do you know what you're getting yourself into? You've never done anything like this before, you could hurt yourself, you're broadcasting it to the whole world. And he was completely right on all of those things. All of that is completely accurate. But I did well, and ironically, even though every challenge has got progressively more intense and more dangerous, he's only been more and more supportive as time going on. Preparing for these challenges is tough. It's a whole thing, and you sort of just have to figure out how to do it for yourself. Learning the skills is one thing. I'm a scientist, so going into the first challenge, I have a lot of remote experience, a lot of plant knowledge and animal knowledge, those kinds of things, all of which are extremely applicable to Naked and Afraid and to survival in general, as well as general outdoor skills. But I really dug deep into training myself on primitive skills, and I had to approach that. I only had about a month before my first challenge, so I had to approach that analytically, looking for shortcuts, which actually was a really great way to learn survival and learn to be adaptable. You read many survival guides, at least, and it'll just have lists of trap designs or lists of shelter designs and that kind of thing. And you'll think, if you don't know much, you're like, okay, I guess I just have to memorize these to learn the skills. But for me, it's not really about that. It's about learning the concepts of, like, what aspects of a good shelter will keep you dry and keep you protected from the elements. For determining edibility for plants, for example, you don't have to memorize every single plant. Honestly, no one could if you're thinking about all the different environments around the world. But if you want to test if something's edible, for example, you can take it, rub it on a rough area of skin, If you don't have a negative reaction to that, rub it on a more sensitive area of skin. Wait a while. If you don't have a reaction, rub it on the inside of your lips. No reaction, chew it up a little bit, spit it out. If you don't have a reaction to that, chew up a tiny bit, swallow it, wait a while, eat a little bit more. And if you follow those steps progressively, if you have a negative reaction, it's not gonna be that bad. But that's how you determine if something's edible. So I use that a lot in the field. Even though I'm a biologist, even though I have plant knowledge, I don't know every single plant around the world that I'm not gonna present to. But there's a lot of shortcuts like that to survival that I've been able to implement and learn these shortcuts, these methods to sort of figure everything out. But honestly, primitive skill is only a very small part of survival. I swear it's 85% mental, and I'm not even exaggerating that. You have to put yourself in the right mental state. And my trick, I didn't even think it was a trick, of doing that is to prepare for it to be absolute hell on earth. And when it's not absolute hell on earth out there, you're pleasantly surprised rather than crumbling. If it is hell on earth, you're like, okay, yeah, this is what I expected. The Amazon was hell on earth for sure. And it's interesting. You'll see a lot of people, certain personality types, hype themselves up for these challenges by saying, oh, I've got this. I'm going to kill it. I'm going to dominate my environment on the first day. It's going to be great. And inevitably, when that doesn't happen, they crumble. Ironically, because of that, women actually tend to do a lot better on these challenges than men in general. The most challenging physical thing that's happened to me on Naked and Afraid by far, probably ever in my life, is my 60-day challenge in the Amazon. On that challenge, over half of the contestants started out with 12. Over half of them left by day 6, which never happens, because of the bugs. It was brutal. Not only was it rainy and you're covered in mud, but there were bugs all over you 24/7. Every inch of your body had, I'm not exaggerating, probably at least a dozen bug bites, if not more. You were just, your whole body was swollen, your ankles were swollen. You couldn't bump into anything without just this intense burning sensation because of the mosquito bites all over your body. On top of that, there were biting flies that would leave these welts all over you. At night, when you laid down, there were these little flea things that crawled all over you, which didn't bite, but were not fun. So 24/7, there were bugs all over your body. The fire didn't help, smoke didn't help, ash didn't help. All of the typical survival tricks to get rid of bugs didn't help. So it was literal pure human torture. It was bad. It took until I had a solid rainproof shelter up, which was dark in the very back, to get some solace from the bugs, because the bugs don't like to fly in the dark. So once I had that in a raised bed in the back, which took a while to make, it took about 6 days to get it really dark, that helped. But especially that first week on that challenge was absolutely brutal. Most people, I don't react to mosquitoes that much. In my house, I live in the rainforest, in the jungle. It's a very open air in the forest house. And there's a lot of bugs, a lot of mosquitoes in that area. And I forget about them for the most part, but other people will come to my house and get devoured. So I have to have bug spray on hand. Yeah, when I think of my most emotionally challenging experience on Naked and Afraid so far, a couple things come to mind. The first one is the Amazon. Again, I was out there for 60 days, and even though the first week was pure torture, I was pushing through it. But by the middle, around day 30, 35, you've been out there for so long. You've been suffering, devoured by bugs 24/7 for so long, with them all over your body. You're starving, you're withering away, and you're looking ahead, and you still have a month left to sit out there. There was a period where we weren't doing too much. There wasn't too much happening in the middle. We were just sort of going about our lives and hunting and fishing and that kind of thing. So there's a little bit of a lull in it. Yeah, it's tough. It's really hard to dig yourself out of those mental spaces sometimes. second most challenging was probably the first season of Last One Standing. Last One Standing is the competition spinoff that just started last year, brand new show. And that created a whole new ball game. You know, not only were we out there surviving and battling against the elements as we always do. But we were doing these grueling physical challenges, and there was a lot more mental games associated with that. Everyone's out there to win $100,000. Everyone's out against each other. So you had to like add this whole other mental twist to it to try to understand what everyone's thinking, what everyone's doing. The normal Naked and Afraid is just about building each other up and working together and trying to finish together. This one, it's everyone for themselves, you know? So you don't necessarily know what everyone's thinking. You can't necessarily trust everybody. And it gets tricky, it gets tricky. And all of that on top of the regular grueling survival is a lot to handle. And it's obviously exactly the same on the second season that's airing now on Discovery. But yeah, adapting to working through the hard times on these challenges has taught me some incredible life skills. I think I just sort of developed this out of necessity out there to make it through. But you go through some horrible, grueling physical experiences. Again, you're just covered in bugs. Sometimes it gets close to freezing and you're just laying there shivering at night. It's raining. It can be absolutely terrible. But a lot of people will go through those experiences. They'll think of home, they'll think of their loved ones and all these things in their life, and it will cause them to crumble. But the ones that really succeed on these challenges, that do them over and over again, have found this incredible way to adapt to that. They've found this incredible way to adapt to that by thinking through all of these things in their life and getting joy from it, gaining joy and appreciation for all the things that you have in your life, all the things you have to look forward to, all the food you have to look forward to. And ironically, when you think about those more, if you're able to, it can create more joy. So the more miserable you are, the more you're thinking about those things, and the more joy it brings to you in that moment. So it's interesting that the like joy and good feelings, to a certain extent, can also increase in tandem with the misery you're experiencing in that moment, which is such a powerful method for getting through those hard times, not only out there, but in your regular life. It's one thing that from these challenges I've been able to bring into my regular life, and it's been profound, actually. The sense of accomplishment when you're done with these things is absolutely overwhelming. It just brings me to tears every single time, literally. You're just fantasizing about that moment when you're out there the whole time. You know, you're having fun in a sense, sure, but you're going through a lot. You know, I lost 60 pounds. I was 60 pounds lighter than I am now when I finished the Amazon season. I was just like a little crazy skeleton. And mentally, you're in a very different place. But I remember the extraction on the Amazon. We were on this rickety little raft. We paddle it out into the Amazon rainforest, six of us on this little handmade thing made out of sticks and rope. And we saw this giant vessel, the largest vessel in the Peruvian Navy, just sitting there in the Amazon. We had to paddle over in the raging river to the bow of the ship. I had this big, like, Tina Turner Thunderdome-looking feather headdress, a little, like, headband, all this stuff on, and war paint. We, like, smashed against the bow of the ship. The Peruvian Navy was on the ship. They let down these ropes, and we had to, like, tie our little raft. We're smashing against the bow. I went over, raised my hands up, they grabbed my wrists, and pulled my naked body. I'm just sobbing because I'm so happy. Pulled my naked body up the side of the ship in the sun on a black ship. It just like smacked against the side and it's like scraping up. I'm crying. I swear I saw myself from third person point of view and I was like, what choices in my life led me to this moment right now? But I got up there and my naked stinky body hugged every Peruvian man on that boat. But it was an amazing feeling of accomplishment. And after that, I did the first season of Last One Standing, the competition spinoff, and I came in second place by seconds, literal seconds. But I was out there for 45 days, and even though I wasn't first place, I was second place by seconds, and that accomplishment alone, seeing how far I've come over these five challenges of the past 6 years, it was absolutely, absolutely incredible. And I can't tell you how the second season of Last One Standing, that's currently airing on Discovery Now, ends. But that was incredible in itself. I work as a biologist for the Papahanaumokuakea Marine National Monument. I organize remote expeditions, I do permitting, logistics, biology. I often lead the expeditions out to these remote areas and do a lot of biological surveys or different management needs depending on what's going on each island, what species I'm working with. But through all these expeditions, I get a lot of leave. So I use all that leave. I work and work and work. I use all my leave to go suffer in the wilderness. And then I come back and go to work again. So it's been two seasons of Last One Standing, the competition spinoff. I've been on both. I'm a returnee for the second season after coming in second place on the first by literal seconds. And it is a whole new ballgame. If you saw the first season of Last One Standing, it was intense. They're trying to fit the organic chaos of Naked and Afraid into this competition. And it's weird and it's incredible, but it puts your skills to the test so immensely, it's not even funny. We are doing challenges out there every 5 days. Some of these challenges are multi-day challenges. And every single challenge that we do involves pulling knowledge from all facets of your skill set and putting it all to the test. It requires physical ability, mental ability, stamina, endurance, and most of all, the most important primitive survival skill of all, creativity and resourcefulness. But at any moment, there's one little choice you make can make or break you in the challenge. Your ability to find food, for example, if you can't source food out there and you can't keep yourself energized, you're not gonna do well in the challenges and you're not gonna progress. So everything out there is sort of this like crazy mental puzzle, this crazy game that you have to play in your mind, not only with your physical abilities and your skills, but with the other people out there. But you have to put it all together in order to be the last one standing, to win that $100,000 prize. So after getting so close on season one, I am extremely motivated on season two to get to the end. But this season finale should be airing on September 15th on the Discovery Channel. Yeah, you know, I think our ancient ancestors really needed to be scientists in a way. There's so much resourcefulness and creativity and experimentation that goes with survival. You have to constantly experiment. Just think of how we know what's edible and what's poisonous. It took a lot of trial and error. But what I find really interesting, sparked my brain, is when you're out there, this starts happening about 2 weeks in, you're brain, the way your brain functions completely changes. And it's something only few people that I've spoken to outside of Naked and Afraid have ever experienced. Something only people who've lived with tribes in the Amazon for months at a time. But your brain, even though you're suffering, becomes very clear. All of this fog that's in your mind that you don't even realize is there goes away. And I think it's a product of living in modern society. You know, on my phone alone, I'm trying to keep active. I could probably list 200 things at once that I'm like thinking about in my brain each day, along with everything else in my life. It's a lot. When you're out there, even though you're going through a lot mentally and physically, it is much more simple. The calculations of what you have to do to better yourself and nourish yourself are a lot simpler. And I think because of that, your brain becomes clearer. The way you process what you have to do in the moment is much clearer. The way you look back on the choices you've made in your entire life and what's important to you and what's not important to you and the choices you have to make going forward in life and what you need to do going forward in life to get where you want to be just becomes so painfully clear in a way that's very difficult to articulate almost. But it seems to me, when I'm in that mode, it feels to me like that's how the human brain is meant to function, honestly. But people in modern society just don't realize that because we've never experienced it. It's just, your brain is just so much more efficient, and it's really profound. It's an experience I wish everyone could have in their life at least once.
Yes.
I'll be your belay.
Quick. We tie it around a tree branch on the bottom. I have Fernando and Trish hold it so it won't pull through.
Go.
We got it. Just go.
Give me lots of slack.
All right, you got it, Dan.
Climbing.
It's an important skill to learn for this environment. Like, you have to put in work and have bushcraft skills to be able to get this down.
He's getting there. Oh, come on, Dan. You're so close. You got it, buddy.
I got it.
Fernando and I are just holding on at the bottom as hard as we can to keep that rope tight. Look at those skills. Watch your head. Heads up. Ooh. All right. Yep.
Hey, bud, I got you. Come down.
Nice work, Dan.
It's exciting, not only because we get this item, but it was the first test of our abilities as a team and our communication. And the three of us together, most importantly, I think communicate really, really well. So I'm really happy with this group, actually.
Hell yeah, buddy. Good job. Good job.